Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavatpad Sankaram Lokasankaram Sankaram Sankaracharyam Keshavam Bhadarayanam Sutra Bhashya Kritovande Bhagavando Punah Punaha Om Sri Ganesh Sarada Guru Bhyo Namaha. In the last class, we talked about the nature of the meditator, the Atman, in the verse Avikaraya Shuddhaya. He talked how it is important for the person who meditates to be vikara rahita. He should be beyond ragas and dvishas, likes and dislikes, and he should have equanimity of mind. And then we read the verse Shrutva Dharmana Sheshena. That is the very first verse of the Vishnu Sahasranama. Now, Shankara, while writing a commentary on this verse, usually the way the Bhashya works is, before the verse, they give an introduction to the what is going to be said in the verse. So he wants to prepare, before meditation, he wants to prepare the meditator to acquire certain qualities so that the meditation will be very smooth. That in mind, Shankara starts his Bhashya. And also, since the Bhashya is very first work for Shankara, Shankara starts with Vishnu Sahasranama. That's the very first book he ever wrote. So in order to complete his spiritual journey, in order to complete this work, he himself is offering a prayer. Shankara himself is offering a prayer, and Shankara's Ishta Devata is Guruvayur Krishna. He coming from that area, Kalati. So he writes a sloka saying, Sachidananda Rupaya Krishnaya Aklishta Karmane. I salute Krishna who has actions which are aklishta, which are not difficult at all. He performs actions like srishti of this world and all very naturally, because he is in the form of consciousness and all knowledge. He knows everything and he is conscious of everything. So whatever actions comes through Krishna, it's all aklishta, without any klesha. Then he goes on quoting three verses from Harivamsa Purana. So these three verses, he thinks that it is extremely essential before you start worship of any divinity, including Vishnu. So that three verses comes from a section called Kailasa Yatra. The Harivamsa Purana itself is not a Purana, though the word Purana is attached to it. The Puranas are 18 in number. Madvayam, Badvayam Cheva, Bratrayam, Vachatushtayam. Vachatushtayam means Varaha, Vayu, Vamana and Vishnu. Bratrayam means Brahma Vaivarta, Brahmanda, Brahma Purana. And Madvayam means Matsya and Markandeya. And Anabalinga Kuskani means Agni, Narada, Linga, Kurma and Skanda. Na, Pa, Ling, Ga, Kuskani. Pa is Padma. So these are the 18 Puranas. Harivamsa is not part of this, but it is called a Kila Bhaga of the Mahabharata. Kila means an appendix, an addendum. So after writing this 100,000 odd verses, Vyasa also writes this Harivamsa exclusively for Krishna, Hari's Vamsa. So there, this Kailasa Yatra, Krishna travels to Manasarovar and meets Shiva there. And Shiva tells these to Krishna as soon as he sees them. That Shankara quotes before starting his commentary on the Vishnu Sahasranama. What are those verses? Shiva Uvacha. Namani Tava Govinda Yani Loke Mahanticha Tanyeva Mama Namani Natra Karya Visharana. So, don't do too much of analysis. Whatever names they are using for you, hey Govinda, all those names are mine too. There is no need for any further analysis. All your names are mine. That is the first verse. The next one is, Tudupasya Jagannatha Saivastu Mama Gopate. Whoever is your Upasaka, whoever is a Vishnu Upasaka, all those are Mama Upasakas Chapi. They are all, O Gopate, they are all my Upasakas as well. So they are all actually worshipping me as well. Yascha Tvam Deshti Bho Deva. And whoever is hating you, Tvam Yaha Dveshti, 4 is a Shivadveshi. Samam Dveshti Nasamshaya. Definitely, whoever is your Dveshti, meaning Vishnu Dveshi, whoever is hating Vishnu, he is also hating Shiva. That Shiva says to Krishna in the Kailasa Parva of the Harivamsa Purana. This Shankara quotes, saying that there is Shiva Vishnu Aikyam. There is no essential difference between Vishnu and Shiva, because they are all Brahmanaha Shaktihi. They are the creative and destructive powers of the same Parabrahman. That is Shankara's take on it. And then during our daily rituals, we also chant these verses. Shivaya Vishnu Rupaya, Shiva Rupaya Vishnave, Shivasya Hridayam Vishnuhu, Vishnustu Hridayam Shivaha. It means that Shiva's form is verily Vishnu's form, and Vishnu's form is verily Shiva's form. And Shiva's heart is Vishnu, and Vishnu's heart is Shiva. What is Vishnu's heart? Vishnu's heart means his opinion. What is in your heart means what is your opinion. So Vishnu and Shiva, they don't differ in their opinions. They have the same thought process. And one more verse we chant in the Nityakarma is, Yatha Shivamayo Vishnuhu, Vishnudeva Shivamayaha, Yatha Antaran Napashyami, Tatha Me Sustihi Ayushe. So as long as I don't see difference between Shiva and Vishnu, Yatha Vishnumaya Shivaha, I see Vishnu as Shiva himself, Tatha Me Ayushe Susti, I'll have all well-beings. So with this non-dual vision, he asks us to have this attitude. Why he, Shankara, says this is because when you meditate, the meditation as explained in the Gita and the Dhyana Yoga, he says, Tam vidya dukkha sanyoga vyogam yoga samyutam. Krishna says, Sa nischayena yoktavyaha. You go and with nischaya sit down. But by sitting, meditation does not happen. Because he calls it dukkha samyoga vyogam. All your dukkha samyoga will have vyoga. They will all go away. But that is not our experience. When we sit, per dukta hai, we have pain, cramps in the body, all this is happening. That is because meditation is not icha-based. The nischaya is only just like any other activity. I'm going to swim. You can say that and go and swim, but you need to have that balance. Same thing with cycling. Similarly, in meditation, only that sitting part is will-based. The meditation itself will not happen because of your will. It will happen, the process will happen by itself. You don't have any control in the actual meditation itself. So that is why Shankara is saying that to set up those, to set up those, you need this vision of duality. You should not be idealistic, that ideas of nationhood, that I belong to certain caste, certain creed, certain nation, and I am superior to the other nation, or I belong to certain divine sect, and that sect is superior to other sects. So, and obviously in Shankara's period, Shiva and Vishnu, they were both very powerful isms, or very powerful schools of thought. Before Shankara, we had so many Nayanmars in Tamil Nadu, 64 Shaivite saints. So they had great angst towards Vaishnavism and Vishnu's devotees. So he wanted to kind of indicate that meditation requires emotional maturity. You cannot cringe on idealism and take it as a point to differentiate Brahman, the divinity. So you should be able to have that emotional maturity before you enter the altar of Vishnu. That is what he was trying to say with these three quotations. And then there was another Shankaracharya, his name is Upanishad Yogendra. He was a very great yogi. He had written 110 commentaries on Upanishads, 110 Upanishads. So he used to be in Kanchipuram, and the mutt is called Upanishad Brahmendra Matha. Even still we have that lineage coming down. So he also has written these famous songs, Manasa Sancharare, in the movie Shankarabharanam, that is written by him. In Sarvam Brahmamayam, Re Re Sarvam Brahmamayam, that is written by Upanishad Brahmendra. Then Pibale Ramarasam, that is also written by this Upanishad Brahmendra. He is one of the saints who had Sajiva Samadhi, meaning he went and sat and asked the devotees to put mud on him. So he still believed to exist in a village called Nerur, which is close to Karur near Salem in Tamil Nadu. So that is called Sadashiva Brahmendra Peetham. There he continues to bless his devotees. But he also is a very gigantic philosopher. He has written so many commentaries on this, all these Upanishads. No Upanishad has been left. Even Shankara wrote only 10. So he has written a book called Upeya Nama Artha Viveka. So he analyzes Nama and Artha. He says that Nama and Nami are the same. So when you say Rama, you obviously mean Lord Rama. And he says that there is no difference between the name and the named. And even he says at the end that the name is actually superior to the Nami, superior to the person. Why? Because when you go to Rajakarya to accomplish things, you just tell the king's name. The king is not present, but it opens the doors. So he gives such examples and says that the name is actually holier than Vishnu. It is more powerful. He says all those things. There are only 56 verses, but the 11th or 12th verse is very interesting verse. He brings out this concept called Nama Aparadha, that before chanting the japa, before chanting the names of any divinity, before meditating, you need to take care you don't commit these 10 big offenses. If you commit these offenses, he calls it Gajasnanam, like the elephant taking bath. You go and take the bath, then it comes out and puts the mud, because it is very itchy, the water is very itchy. So he wants to take care of the itch, so he puts the mud over his body. So again, it's all over dirty. So that is the case if you don't take care of this 10 offenses. And what are these 10 offenses? This is the verse. Sanninda asati nama vaibhava katha srishesha yor bhedadihi asraddha sruti shastra deshika giram namni arthavada brahmaha namastidu nishiddha vritti vihita tyago karmantare samyam namani shangarasya jaharer nama aparadha dasha. This is the big verse. So the first offense before starting japa yajna is sanninda, the ninda of sat, of saints, of sadvipras or mahatmas. You should not commit that offense. You should not insult the sat. You should not say they don't know anything. That you should not say. You should not behave like all-knowing than the great acharyas. Or any mahatma, you should not do any ninda. Number two, asati nama vaibhava katha. You should not reveal all this greatness of the holy name of Sahasranama. It should not be revealed to asat, a person who is who's wicked, who has no interest in spirituality. Why force him? You don't have to go and tell him the greatness, vaibhava of the nama. Third thing is, what we mentioned earlier, Srishesha yor bhedadihi. Srisha, Sriyaha Isha. Sriyaha Isha is Vishnu. Sri is Lakshmi. Isha is Lord. The Lord of Sri is Vishnu, Srisha. And Isha, Isha means Shiva. So between Srisha and Isha, bhedadihi. You should not differentiate. They are one and the same. The Veda also says, Edudadaram Andaram Kurute Atatasyabhayam Bhavati. One who creates Bheda, he actually creates Bhaya. When there is separation, then there is fear. Mm-hmm. He will think, what will Shiva come and do to me? So that kind of fear will happen because of the Bheda. And also Bhedagrit Papagrit Bhavet. One who creates Bheda, he also commits a Papa. It's an offense against the name. This is the third aparadha. The fourth one is Ashraddha Srutishu. Since all this information is coming from the Vedas, you should never commit asraddha towards the Veda. Veda you should not then. Second, that is the fourth one. The fifth one is Ashraddha Shastreshu. The Shastras, which are actually commentaries of the Vedas. There are six in numbers. The Sankhya Yoga, Sankhya of Kapila, Yoga of Patanjali. Pura Uttara Mimamsa, Pura Mimamsa of Jaimini, Uttara Mimamsa of Vyasa. And the other two Shastras are Nyaya and Vaisheshika. The Nyaya Shastra of Kanada and Vaisheshika Shastra of Gautama Maharshi. These Shastras, you should not commit any Ninda. You should respect them. Then Deshik Giram, the instructor, the person who is Dishati, is Deshikaha. Him also you should not do Ninda. Then Namni Arthavada Brahmaha, that's number 7. This Arthavada is called exaggeration. In Vedas you will find verses which says, Vayuhu Kshepishtha Devata. Vayu is the most fastest of all gods. So there are faster gods, but still, because when you are extolling Vayu, or you, if somebody gives you like $10, you will say you are Kubera. You are he knows that he is not Kubera, and the person who tells this also knows that it is not the truth. It's a white lie. But he just exaggerates the truth. But in the case of Nama, you should not believe that whatever the Shastra says about Nama is an exaggeration. You have to take it literally. If they say in the Kalisandra Upanishad, it says, Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama Iva Kevalam, Kalo Nasteva, Nasteva, Nasteva Gadiranyatha. In the Kali Yuga, there is only one way to escape the pangs of suffering. That is Harinama. Mm. And when the Upanishad says that, you have to take it at face value. You cannot say that Upanishad is just extolling Hari's virtues. No, that is not the case. So, never consider Nama's Mahima as exaggeration. Every single extolling of Nama's virtue is true. That should be your attitude before Japa. There is a 7th offense, Nama Aparadha. The 8th one is Nama Astiti Nishiddha Vritti. Now I have got this Upadesha. So I will do any Nishedha Karma. I will commit any amount of sins. Then I will chant 1000 Gayatri or 1000 Ashtakshari. By saying Namo Narayana, all my papas will go away. No, that is not the case. So never do Nishiddha Vritti because of the power of Nama. Don't use it for your worldly issues, to kill your Shatru or whatever. And also Vihita Tyagaha, that's the 9th one. Vihita Tyaga means you are ordained certain responsibilities. As a human being, you have to take care of parents, you have to take care of your Kula Devata, Grama Devatas, Nishta Devatas. And you have to take care of human beings, your atithis. You have social responsibilities. You should not say that I am chanting, so ask him to come later. No, you have to find time, you have to balance out. Names you can chant, but your social responsibilities, your parental responsibilities, and your divine responsibilities, all those, that's all vihita karma. You have to fulfill them, don't do tyaga. That is the 9th aparadha. The last one is karmantare samyam. Karmantara means like dana, danaha shakti kalau yuge, and also bhuri bhojana, giving food to many people. These are all good karmas. But don't consider namajaba is equal to that. Don't consider that namajaba is, they have their own value. They may be superior, but don't consider namajaba is something inferior to them. So don't compare the japayajna to other good karmas. Japa has its own greatness. So these are the 10 offenses one should avoid before chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama. Now we will go to the first verse of Vishnu Sahasranama. So it says, Sri Vaishampayana Uvacha Shrutva dharmana sheshena pavanani cha sarvasah yudhishthirashantanavam punarevabhyavashata. Now he says Sri Vaisampayana Uvacha. Who says this? Actually the Suta Puranika, Suta Uvacha, that's how all the Purana starts, including Mahabharata. So Suta is narrating this Puranas to Shaunaka. He is another Rishi. So Suta Maharshi is telling it to Shaunaka Rishi. And in the course of the Purana, other people also come. So Vaisampayana comes in that story, sub-story. So Vaisampayana is actually telling it to Janamejaya. So we don't know this context, so Shankara comments there. Shankara says, Vaishampayana Uvacha. Then he says, Janamejayam Prati. He is telling it to Janamejaya. And what is Vaishampayana telling to Janamejaya? Yudhishthira Shantanavam Abhibhashata. He is saying that Yudhishthira asked Shantanu, son, Shantanavam. So that is the conversation. Vaishampayana telling Janamejaya that Yudhishthira is asking Bhishma. So that is how Puranas work. There will be several internal stories. Inside the story, there will be stories. So there Shankara comments that this Vaishampayana is actually telling it to Janamejaya, because we don't see Janamejaya. He is explaining that. So what does he ask? Shrutva dharman asheshena. Asheshena. Shesham means a little bit remaining. Ashesha means nothing to remain. Every dharma, every possible dharma has been explained by Bhishma to Yudhishthira. It is called Dana Dharma Parva. All the dharmas, Raja Dharma, Kshatriya Dharma, Brahmana Dharma, Sudra Dharma, Vaishya Dharma, Varnashrama Dharmas, Yati Dharma, Brahmachari Dharma, Grihastha Dharma, Vanaprastha Dharma, all these are Ashesha Dharma. All these dharmas was heard by Yudhishthira. Having Shrutva, Pavanani, and they are all purifying. So here Shankara writes, what is this dharma? He says, Chodana Lakshanaha Dharmaha. So that actually is a sutra from Jaimini in the Mimamsa Shastra. Dharma, the first sutra is Athato Dharma Jijnasa. I now am going to inquire into dharma. That's how Jaimini starts. And there are about 4,000 sutras. And in the second sutra, he says, Chodana Lakshanaha Dharmaha. Dharma means Chodana. That is the definition of Dharma. So Shankara actually quotes Jaimini, says that Dharma here is Chodana. So he agrees with the Purva Mimamsakas. Shankara will agree with all schools of thought, as far as it is not against non-duality. If it agrees with Advaita, he will accept everyone. He will include everyone. Only thing is, he is very particular about Advaita. That unity and the non-duality, that oneness of the universal truth, that cannot be compromised. That is the only thing. So he accepts Jaimini's definition as Chodana Lakshana. So in Jaimini, there are several great commentators. I mean, Bhata, Shabara, these are all commentators. Bhata explains this Chodana as Chodana cha upadeshascha vidischa ekartha vachikaha. Chodana, Upadesha and Vidhi, all the three means the same. Remember last class we discussed about the main part of the Veda is Vidhi. And that Vidhi is Martavya Satato Vishnu. Remember Vishnu always. The other part is Nisheda, never forget him. So Vidhi is the essence of Veda. And Chodana is that Vidhi. So that is the definition of Dharma. Dharma means Vidhiyate, an injunction. It's a thing which says you do. For example, Aharaha Sandhyam Upasita. Morning and evening you do Upasana. We don't know that these are the junctures or these are the times that Upasana has to be done, unless we understand the Veda. Or Vruddha Vakya. Somebody who has read the Veda has to convey this. But the knowledge of Upasana can come only from the Vedas. Other than that literature, we don't have any other source. So Veda is the only source for Dharma. That is how Shankara defines this Dharma. And this Chodana is, when you say it is just Chodana, then there are several Upadesha Vakyas in the Vedas, which say Satyam Vada, Dharmanchara, those will be excluded. That is why Bhata is trying to say, it is not just Prachodana, not just inspiring you to do actions, but it is also Upadesha, instructions. So he wants to bring all these other Vakyas under the purview of Dharma. That is why the commentator of Mimamsa, of Mimamsa Shastra of Jaimini, he brings out the left out meaning. Because when the teacher first says, he assumes that people will understand all the aspects of Dharma. But when time goes on, certain aspects becomes very unclear. So he clarifies it saying that It is not just injunction vidhi, it is also upadesha and chodana. Upadesha, chodana and vidhi, all the three are like chodana or dharma. Now this, what he essentially does is called vakya vichara or analysis of sentence. So this analysis of sentence, this Bhatta, Prabhakara, Misraj, they all have different ways of looking at the word dharma. How can it be possible means, in ancient India, linguistics of Panini, they had given so much of importance to brevity of expression. So, and they used to analyze sentences. In modern times, we have this theory called behavioral theory of in sentences. They take sentences and analyze it and have several theories of analyzing the meaning of sentences, like relative theory of sentences, or ideational theory of sentences in economics, in sociology. And ideational theory is when you say a car, that word car could mean only the car, nothing else. This was proposed by John Locke in the 1600s. So, but the problem with this theory for later linguists was, who will decide that the car would tell only that object? So they couldn't fix the meaning. So they had to give away that idea of ideation theory of sentence and go to relational theory of sentence. In relational theory, attributes are explained by sentences. If you say that the brave boy jumps, so the brave talks about the quality of the boy, the word boy talks about the person, and jumps talks about the action. So the actions, attributes and people, person, that is explained by the sentences. But again, those are also not fixated for later linguistics. So they gave up, and the latest theory is the behavioral theory. It's widely used in economics and psychology. And this Jaimini's theory of sentences are very akin to this. When you say sorgakamo ejeta, for example, there is a Vedic sentence which says sorgakamo ejeta. So a person who is interested in sorga should do the yaga. So it assumes people with only certain behavior who have read the Vedas, who have desire for this sorga, will be inspired to do this act of Ashwamedha Yaga. Others will just hear it. It will not invoke any behavior in them. So these, all these theories were thought about and exposed by all these acharyas. If you look at all these great acharyas, they will spend a lot of time in hair-splitting arguments to bring out about these meanings of these words. Why they do is, they want to go into the ultimate meaning of the word, so that no doubt remains in expressing the ideas from these sentences. Then only they will be able to bring about their siddhanta or their conclusion about this. That's what Shankara is trying by quoting Jaimini. He wants to say that Mahabharata has Vedic status, and whatever tools you are using in the Vedic analysis, all the mimamsa, that can be applied herein. That's what he is trying to. It is all meta language. It is a little bit very technical, but it has to be applied because it is Panchama Vedaha, it's part of the Veda. So he, Shankara Bhashya, he uses this word Chodana Lakshanaha for Dharma. So Asheshena Dharman Srutva, having heard all these dharmas, which are Pavanani, Pavanani means which are purifying. There Shankara says, Pavana means Pavana Hetu, that which can purify you. How can it purify you? In two ways. He says, by giving you Abhyudaya and Nisrayas. Abhyudaya means the worldly accomplishments. For that you can do Vishnu's name chanting. Suppose you want more rupa or more food or more wealth. For that the chanting of the Sahasranama can be used, and you can get those worldly results by doing this. And also it can give you nisrayas. It's called moksha dharma. You can get the final beatitude, final moksha by chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama. So it is both abhyudaya and nisraya sahetur dharmaha, which is presented in this Vishnu Sahasranama. That is why he says it is pavanani. It is actually very purifying, because once you have these worldly desires, you cannot be pure. You will not be ready for meditation. So it does provide you with all this worldly success, and eventually when you are ready emotionally mature, at that time it also can give you the nisrayas, the final beatitude. And then what happened? Yudhishthiraha Shantanavam. So Shantanavam, he says, is Bhishma, because Shantanu had other children like Vijitravirya. So he also is Shantanu, like Pandava can be Arjuna and Yudhishthira. So he writes, it is Bhishma. In this context, Shantanu's son is Bhishma. To whom? Yudhishthiraha. Yudhishthiraha means one who is firm in Yuddha. Because Yudhishthira is a Kshatriya. In the Bhagavad Gita, because even after hearing all these dharmas, what are all dharmas? Nanacharan, vividhan, jati dharman, bhubushade, essa para, avarajnaha. If you want to know about the world, you need to know all the jati dharmas, all the varna dharmas, all the desha dharmas. So if you go to London and if you say that I don't know the etiquette of the Englishman, then you cannot survive there. So you need to know how to behave. There was a minister from Bihar, so he had gone to sign a big deal. He went to London and he was offered this bowl with water, and there was also a lemon on the side. So he saw that guy and took this lemon and squeezed in this bowl. He did not realize it is a finger bowl. It was given to. So he drank it. And our eglaye, bring one more. So that is not acceptable. You have to know all worldly. It is called vividhan jati dharman. All the different classes of society, different sections of society. You need to know their rules and regulations. If you say, I don't know the law, then the law is not at fault. Shankara says, Nayam sthanurabaradaha idandhoyam napishati. You have a big pillar in the center of the hall, you go and hit it. It's not the fault of the pillar. So you need to, if you are a blind man, then you have to take help. But ask, what is the etiquette? How to walk in the hall? And you have to know this dharma. So all this dharma was explained by Bhishma. But punaha abhibhashata. Again, Yudhishthira is asking Bhishma. So Shankara is saying, is beautifully commending this word punaha, again. Shankara says, why again? Then Shankara says, because something was left over. What was left over? Though he had given all the etiquettes and all these dharmas, he had left over an easy path to moksha, which is Vishnu Sahasranama. So that is why he is punaha abhibhashata, he is asking. So Yudhishthira, for the benefit of the world, he wants Bhishma to spell that out. So that is how Shankara comments it. So with that, we will stop for today. The next class will be Yudhishthira Uvacha. Yudhishthira will be starting.
Too many stories to remember,
Yeah, there is no pressure to, in Vedanta Sravana, there is no pressure. So that's why we should not read it. In ancient time, Are Drishtavyaha Atma, Srotavyaha, Mantavyaha, Nididhyasadavyaha. The knowledge of your Atman, of yourself, has to be heard. Because hearing, it does something to you. The direct dialogue, because if you look at all our prayers, Sahana Avabhato, Sahano Bhunaktu, Sahano means two, it is Dvivachana, it's between the teacher and the student. So it's a transaction between only two people. So that's how these are all going to sink in your being. So first you take a cup of coffee and put sugar, and then you suddenly drink it, it will be very bitter, because you have stirred it. That is called abhyasa, that is called practice. But in time, they all will make sense. So in the beginning, when you hear all this, they all will be like, Tukda, here's one information, their own information. But that one picture will come in the right time. That's why Krishna says, Mattaha smritihi jnanam apohanam cha. Mattaha smritihi, from Krishna comes remembrance. Jnanam, understanding. Just because you remember, it doesn't mean that you understand. Then apohanam, also forgetfulness. You can also totally miss it or misunderstand it. Everything comes from me. So the idea is just to listen and it will all make sense. All these myriad stories, there is an essence to all this. That will come in time.
So one thing I didn't understand, you said don't do Vishnu Sahasranama just with expectation or some gains. Is that right? Is something you said, right, in between?
No. All the 10 rules, they are all offenses. And expecting something is not an offense. Because Krishna says, expectation means desire. They're asking, is it wrong to expect something out of chanting this Vishnu Sahasranama? I said there are two results, Abhyudaya and Nisrayasa. Abhyudaya is worldly results. You can expect it.
You can.
And Vishnu Sahasranama will give you that. So, because
it's materialistic,
right? It is materialistic and it is okay. Because Krishna says, dharma aviruddho kamosmi. I am kama. Krishna is actually the grandfather of Kama. Kama is nothing but Pradyumna, who is grandson of Krishna. So it's Krishna's power. So Krishna is actually all desires. But it has to be dharma aviruddha. It should not go against dekram of the Vedas, of the Vedic injunctions. So if those terms are met, then you can ask for houses or for more wealth. They all have dharmic usages. So we can ask for more and more. But you will not be ready for Vedanta until you develop that vairagya. Because you will understand while hearing that these are all cyclic. By getting a house, you are only wanting to have a desire for a bigger house. By wanting a car, you are only wanting to have a better car. By wanting money, you are only having to have more money. So that is very cyclic. Kshine punye marti lokam vishanti. So by doing all this kama requests, finally you'll get big swarga. But even that swarga, when your punya, which you got out of Vishnu Sahasranama, diminishes, then you'll have to come down. And then again, you have to try for moksha. But once you get moksha, it's like pure bliss. It is more beautiful than all these kamas. So hence it is not wrong to ask for abhyudaya or worldly kama, but nisrayas is the best. And that is reserved only for people who are very close to Vishnu. Krishna says, Chaturvidha bhajan devam. Four kind of people come and do bhajana to me. Janaha sukritino arjuna. Hey Arjuna, they are sukritis. They have done lot of good karmas in their past. And who are they? Artaha, number one. The person who wants... Artha means a person who is in difficulty. Artha means one who is in pain, one who has lost a loved one, or one who has money in lottery, one who is suffering, one who is in pain. That's Artha. That's the number one. He will come to the temple to Krishna. Number two, Artharthi, one who wants Artha, one who wants money, some prayojana. Artha means prayojana, or basically money. The third one, Artharthi, Jidnyasuhu, one who is curious. What is in there? What is written in that? He wants to know. And the fourth one is Jnani. The last one is the one who has understood. He has gone through the stages in previous lives or in this life. He has attained that spiritual maturity, and that is Jnani. Tesham Jnani Nitya Yuktaha Same Bhakta Same Priya. Among all these four, Jnani is the most dearest to me, because he is Nitya Yuktaha. He never falls from the path, and he is Priya. And Jnani Tvatmeva Me Matam. He is my own Atma. There is no difference me and he has attained Krishna, so he has no difference. Hence, that is the idealistically, that is the best desire. But we shouldn't get stuck with hopes or futuristic things. Wherever you are, that's where you have to blossom. If you are on earth, blossom here. Once you reach heaven, you can do things which are proper in Vaikuntha or Brahmaloka or Shivaloka. But here, in whichever stage God has kept you, in which wherever you are, from there you start. But intensely, if you pray, then He will give you. And there is no greater gain other than gaining Krishna, becoming Him.
There's another one I want to ask you, which caused confusion in me. You said, just for the sake of meditation, if you desire to meditate and sit down to meditate, you can never attain meditation.
No, because...
What if the Guru guides you and tells you?
The Guru only can guide you. Guru can only tell you. My mother can come, sleep. Will you sleep? If you have a desire to listen to some music or something you want to do, if that is blocking your thing, will you be able to sleep? Tell me. You won't be able to sleep. Similarly, meditation also. Meditation is what? Becoming one with... What is meditation? Meditation means Tayaladharavat Manasaha Avichinena Vastushu Avasthanam. Avasthana means stability, staying in vastu. How? Just like a stream of oil. When the oil is flowing, there is no break. It is just one streak. Just like that, the mind has to flow into the vastu, the object of meditation. That is called meditation. And that cannot be forced. You just cannot force that state, because it is an internal state which cannot be forced. So that is why in the Yoga Sutras, he says the first sutra is Yogaha or meditation, Chitta Vritti Nirodaha. All you can do is the Nirodha of all your external thoughts, your hankerings for this, that. That if you just a cessation, when all those secede, what is left is meditation. That cannot be forced. That is what I meant. So I was not saying that it is impossible, but it is not will-based. Just like making a chapati is your will-based. It's an action. You can say that my chapati is square, a triangle, or a round-shaped one. But you cannot will that in the case of meditation. It is not an objective. It's not an object you can see or attain. It is an experience, which is you. You being yourself, that is meditation. For that only you can create that situation. You can create that situation. But you cannot force that.
So with discipline and practice, they say meditation is possible.
Yes.
If your guru guides you.
Yeah.
The guru tells you what to do.
The only way is the guru's guidance.
Blessing of the grace and yes. Blessing grace of the guru. Yes. That would happen.
Yes. So even then, it's not your grace. Even then, it's not your will. See, guru's grace.
It'll but happen. You have to have a yearning too for that.
Yes. That's why in the beginning he says, Samishchayana Yoktavyaha. You have to have that earning.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have that will to do. But there ends your path. Beyond that, It is the object of meditation, then it takes over. Vishnu or Krishna, he takes over.
So that's what you mean is we should not be analyzing, we should practice him.
Yeah.
We should practice what Guru says, spend our time, and then it's not our will that we can reach him. But when he thinks, he will attract us,
right.
Put us back to the connection with the...
Grace of the God and grace of the Guru.
Yes. Right.
That will lead
That will manifest. That state will manifest in you.
Yes.
It is not something you can do, just you can fight and get like worldly things.
Hmm.
Meditation is a very spiritual dimension. You becoming yourself. Yourself means Krishna. You are the taranga. You are the wave. Krishna is the big ocean. And when you merge in the ocean, then you become that. And it can be savikalpa or nirvikalpa. Savikalpa means you'll come back. You meditate, you go there and come back. Nirvikalpa means you stay there. So there are these different kinds of meditations also explained in the Patanjali Yoga Sutras. But any meditation cannot be will-based. You cannot will it and force it. Even the Guru will not... Words stop there. That is what meditation is. You cannot just say that I started meditation at 10:15. You will never be able to say that. just say that around 10 o'clock I sat and 15 hours later I woke up. But 15 minutes later I woke up. I had a brief spell. But you can never pinpoint that moment because it is not will-based. The time disappears.
Best way is to connect with him all the time. But you do need a guru who will give his power behind that meditation which you'll do. Then we are going to practice and try to, you know, connect as much as we can. And if 24 hours we can connect with him, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Whatever we are doing, but if you are connected to him, that's the best way, isn't it?
Yeah, the idea of meditation is this, having ekagra chitta and then sitting, and it happens. But and that cannot be forced. That cannot be because of your will. But all this peripheral, anugraha of guru, anugraha of ishta, and your own humility, your own sadhana chaturthya sampatti, all these great qualities you have, shama, dhamma, tidiksha, ubharati, shraddha, they all can be peripheral helpings. And then it can happen.
And those 10 rules, we had to be...
That is for chanting Vishnu Sahasranama.
Just for chanting Vishnu Sahasranama, but it is, can't be used there also for when we sit on meditation, that we want to make sure that we are not having any ahankar or disrespecting anybody, and then we are just connecting.
Yeah, all good things can be intermittently useful, but especially when you do Vishnu Sahasranama, at least at that point, like one Mahatma, I think it is Ramadas in Kanyangad. Mm-hmm. When you enter the temple, what you do is put your pair of your slippers outside. Just like that, put the pair of opposites of Raga and Dvesha, everything outside, and then enter the altar. And then you remain in that state. Once you are done, then you can go back to hating your neighbor and back and settle. But at least these. Because you cannot expect to shed away everything overnight. That is what in the last class we said. Abhijet Sudurachara. Even though he is a Durachari, he has bad qualities. Sadureva Mantaviha. Consider him as to be sadhu. Because Kaunteya Pradijanihi. Hey Kaunteya, hey Arjuna, I am doing this Pradijna. I am actually promising you. Name Bhakta Pranashyati. My Bhakta will never perish. So that assurance is there. Okay, then. We'll meet in the next class. Thank you.
ृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करं लोकशङ्करं शङ्करं शङ्कराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ॐ श्रीगणेशशारदागुरुभ्यो नमः.
द लास्ट् क्लास् वि टाक्ड् अबौट् द नेचर् आफ् द मेडिटेटर् द आत्मन् इन् द वर्स् अविकाराय शुद्धाय. वि टाक्ड् हौ it is important for the person who meditates to be vikara rahita. He should be beyond ragas and dveshas, likes and dislikes. And he should have equanimity of mind. And then we read the verse Shrutva Dharmana Sheshena. That is the very first verse of the Vishnu Sahasranama. Now, Shankara, while writing a commentary on this verse, usually the way the Bhashya works is, before the verse, they give an introduction to the what is going to be said in the verse. So he wants to prepare, before meditation, he wants to prepare the meditator to acquire certain qualities so that the meditation will be very smooth. That in mind, Shankara starts his Bhashya. And also, since the Bhashya is very first work for Shankara. Shankara starts with Vishnu Sahasranama. That's the very first book he ever wrote. So in order to complete his spiritual journey, in order to complete this work, he himself is offering a prayer. Shankara himself is offering a prayer, and Shankara's Ishta Devata is Guru Ayur Krishna. He coming from that area, quality. So he writes a sloka saying, Sachidananda Rupaya Krishnaya Aklishta Karmane. I salute Krishna who has actions which are Aklishta, which are not difficult at all. He performs actions like Srishti of this world and all very naturally, because he is in the form of consciousness and all knowledge. He knows everything and he is conscious of everything. So whatever actions comes through Krishna, it's all Aklishta, without any Klesha. Then he goes on quoting three verses from Harivamsa Purana. So these three verses, he thinks that it's extremely essential before you start worship of any divinity, including Vishnu. So that three verses comes from a section called Kailasa Yatra. The Harivamsa Purana itself is not a Purana, though the word Purana is attached to it. The Puranas are 18 in number. Madvayam, Badvayam Cheva, Bratrayam, Vachatushtayam. Vachatushtayam means Varaha, Vayu, Vamana and Vishnu. Bratrayam means Brahma Vaivarta, Brahmanda, Brahma Purana. And Madvayam means Matsya and Markandeya. And Anabalinga Kuskani means Agni, Narada, Linga, Kurma and Skanda. A, Na, Pa, Linga, Kuskani. Pa is Padma. So these are the 18 Puranas. Harivamsa is not part of this, but it is called a Kila Bhaga of the Mahabharata. Kila means an appendix, an addendum. So after writing this 100,000 odd verses, Vyasa also writes this Harivamsa exclusively for Krishna, Hari's Vamsa. So there, this Kailasa Yatra, Krishna travels to Manasarovar and meets Shiva there. And Shiva tells this to Krishna as soon as he sees them. That Shankara quotes before starting his commentary on the Vishnu Sahasranama. What are those verses? Shiva Uvacha. Namani Tava Govinda, Yani Loke Mahanticha, Tanyeva Mama Namani, Natra Karya Visharana. So, don't do too much of analysis. Whatever names they are using for you, hey Govinda, all those names are mine too. There is no need for any further analysis. All your names are mine. That is the first verse. The next one is, Tudupasya Jagannatha Saivastu Mama Gopate. Whoever is your Upasaka? Whoever is a Vishnu Upasaka? All those are Mama Upasakas Chapi. They are all, O Gopate, they are all my Upasakas as well. So they are all actually worshipping me as well. Yascha Tvam Deshti Bho Deva. And whoever is hating you, Tvam Yaha Dveshti, whoever is a Shiva Dveshi, Samam Dveshti Nasamshaya. Definitely, whoever is your Dveshti, meaning Vishnu Dveshi, whoever is hating Vishnu, he is also hating Shiva. That Shiva says to Krishna in the Kailasa Parva of the Harivamsa Purana. This Shankara quotes, saying that there is Shiva Vishnu Aikyam. There is no essential difference between Vishnu and Shiva, because they are all Brahmanaha Shaktihi. They are the creative and destructive powers of the same Parabrahman. That is Shankara's take on it. And then during our daily rituals, we also chant these verses. Shivaya Vishnu Rupaya, Shiva Rupaya Vishnave, Shivasya Hridayam Vishnuhu, Vishnustu Hridayam Shivaha. It means that Shiva's form is verily Vishnu's form, and Vishnu's form is verily Shiva's form. And Shiva's heart is Vishnu, and Vishnu's heart is Shiva. What is Vishnu's heart? Vishnu's heart means his opinion. What is in your heart means what is your opinion. So Vishnu and Shiva, they don't differ in their opinions. They have the same thought process. And one more verse we chant in the Nityakarma is, Yatha Shivamayo Vishnuhu, Vishnudeva Shivamayaha, Yatha Antaran Napashyami, Tatha Me Sustihi Ayushe. So as long as I don't see difference between Shiva and Vishnu, Yatha Vishnumaya Shivaha, I see Vishnu as Shiva himself, Tatha Me Ayushe Susti, I'll have all well-beings. So with this non-dual vision, he asks us to have this attitude. Why he, Shankara, says this is because when you meditate, the the meditation, as explained in the Gita and the Dhyana Yoga, he says, Tam vidya dukkha sanyoga vyogam yoga samyutam. Krishna says, sa nischayena yoktavyaha. You go and with nischaya sit down. But simply by sitting, meditation does not happen. Because he calls it dukkha samyoga vyogam. All your dukkha samyoga will have vyoga. They will all go away. But that is not our experience. When we sit, per dukta hai, you have pain, cramps in the body, all this is happening. That is because meditation is not ichha based. The nischaya is only just like any other activity. I'm going to swim. You can say that and go and swim, but you need to have that balance. Same thing with cycling. Similarly, in meditation, only that sitting part is will based. The meditation itself will not happen because of your will. It will happen, the process will happen by itself. You don't have any control in the actual meditation itself. So, that is why Shankara is saying that to set up those, you need this vision of duality. You should not be idealistic, that ideas of nationhood, that I belong to certain caste, certain creed, certain nation, and I am superior to the other nation, or I belong to certain divine sect, and that sect is superior to other sects. So, and obviously in Shankara's period, Shiva and Vishnu, they were both very powerful isms, or very powerful schools of thought. Before Shankara, we had so many Nayanmars in Tamil Nadu, 64 Shaivate saints. So they had great angst towards Vaishnavism and Vishnu's devotees. So he wanted to kind of indicate that meditation requires emotional maturity. You cannot cringe on idealism and take it as a point to differentiate Brahman, the divinity. So you should be able to have that emotional maturity before you enter the altar of Vishnu. That is what he was trying to say with these three quotations. And then there was another Shankaracharya, his name is Upanishad Yogindra. He was a very great yogi. He had written 110 commentaries on Upanishads, 110 Upanishads. So he used to be in Kanchipuram, and the mutt is called Upanishad Brahmendra Matha. Even still we have that lineage coming down. So he also has written these famous songs, Manasa Sancharare, in the movie Shankarabharanam, that is written by him. In Sarvam Brahmamayam, Re Re Sarvam Brahmamayam, that is written by Upanishad Brahmendra. Then Pibare Ramarasam, that is also written by this Upanishad Brahmendra. He is one of the saints who had Sajiva Samadhi, meaning he went and sat and asked the devotees to put mud on him. So he still believed to exist in a village called Nerur, which is close to Karur near Salem in Tamil Nadu. So that is called Sadashiva Brahmendra Peetham. There he continues to bless his devotees. But he also is a very gigantic philosopher. He has written so many commentaries on this, all these Upanishads. No Upanishad has been left. Even Shankara wrote only 10. So he has written a book called Upeya Nama Artha Viveka. So he analyzes Nama and Artha. He says that Nama and Nami are the same. So when you say Rama, you obviously mean Lord Rama. And there, he says that there is no difference between the name and the named. And even he says at the end that the name is actually superior to the Nami. Superior to the person. Why? Because when you go to Rajakarya to accomplish things, you just tell the king's name. The king is not present, but it opens the doors. So he gives such examples and says that the name is actually holier than Vishnu. It is more powerful. He says all those things. There are only 56 verses, but the 11th or 12th verse is very interesting verse. He brings out this concept called Nama Aparadha, that before chanting the Japa, before chanting the names of any divinity, before meditating, you need to take care you don't commit these 10 big offenses. If you commit these offenses, he calls it gajasnanam, like the elephant taking bath. You go and take the bath, then it comes out and puts the mud, because it is very itchy, the water is very itchy. So he wants to take care of the itch, so he puts the mud over his body. So again, it's all over dirty. So that is the case if you don't take care of this 10 offenses. And what are these 10 offenses? This is the verse. Sanninda asati nama vaibhava katha srishesha yor bhedadihi asraddha shruti shastra deshika giram namni arthavada brahmaha namastidu nishiddha vritti vihita tyago karmantari samyam namani shangarasya jaharer nama aparadha dasha. This is the big verse. So the first offense before starting japa yajna is sanninda, the ninda of sat, of saints, of sadvipras or mahatmas. You should not commit that offense. You should not insult the sat. You should not say they don't know anything. That you should not say. You should not behave like all-knowing than the great acharyas or any mahatma. You should not do any ninda. Number two, asati nama vaibhava katha. You should not reveal all this greatness of the holy name of Sahasranama. It should not be revealed to asat, the person who is in the, who is wicked, who has no interest in spirituality. Why force him? You don't have to go and tell him the greatness, vaibhava of the nama. Third thing is the, what we mentioned earlier, srishesayor bhedadihi. Srisha, Sriyaha Isha. Sriyaha Isha is Vishnu. Sri is Lakshmi. Isha is Lord. The Lord of Sri is Vishnu, Srisha. And Isha, Isha means Shiva. So between Srisha and Isha, Bhedadihi. You should not differentiate. They are one and the same. The Veda also says, Edudadaram Andaram Kurute Atatasyabhayam Bhavati. One who creates Bheda, he actually creates bhaya. When there is separation, then there is fear. Mm-hmm. He will think, what will Shiva come and do to me? So that kind of fear will happen because of the bheda. And also, bhedagrit papagrit bhavet. One who creates bheda, he also commits a papa. It's an offense against the name. This is the third aparadha. The fourth one is asraddha srutishu. Since all this information is coming from the Vedas, you should never commit asraddha towards the Veda. Veda you should not then. That is the fourth one. The fifth one is asraddha shastreshu. The shastras, which are actually commentaries of the Vedas. There are six in numbers. The Sankhya Yoga, Sankhya of Kapila, Yoga of Patanjali, Pura Uttara Mimamsa, Pura Mimamsa of Jaimini, Uttara Mimamsa of Vyasa. And the other two shastras are Nyaya and Vaisheshika. The Nyaya Shastra of Kanada and Vaisheshika Shastra of Gautama Maharshi. These shastras, you should not commit any ninda. You should respect them. Then Deshika Giram, the instructor, the person who is Dishati, is Deshika. Him also you should not do ninda. Then Namni Arthavada Brahmaha, that's number 7. This Arthavada is called exaggeration. In Vedas you will find verses which says, Vayuhu Kshepishtha Devata. Vayu is the most fastest of all gods. So there are faster gods, but still, because when you are extolling Vayu, or you, if somebody gives you like $10, you will say you are Kubera. You are, he knows that he is not Kubera, and the person who tells this also knows that it is not the truth. It's a white lie. But he just exaggerates the truth. But in the case of Nama, you should not believe that whatever the Shastra says about Nama is an exaggeration. You have to take it literally. If they say in the Kalisandra Upanishad, it says, Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama Iva Kevalam, Kalo Nasteva, Nasteva, Nasteva Gadiranyatha. In the Kali Yuga, there is only one way to escape the pangs of suffering. That is Harinama. Mm. And when the Upanishad says that, you have to take it at face value. You cannot say that Upanishad is just extolling Hari's virtues. No, that is not the case. So, never consider Nama's Mahima as exaggeration. Every single extolling of Nama's virtue is true. That should be your attitude before japa. There is a seventh offense, Nama Aparadha. The eighth one is Nama Astiti Nishiddha Vritti. Now I have got this Upadesha. So I will do any Nishedha Karma. I will commit any amount of sins. Then I will chant 1000 Gayatri or 1000 Ashtakshari by saying Namo Narayana, all my papas will go away. No, that is not the case. So never do Nishiddha Vritti because of the power of Nama. Don't use it for your worldly issues, to kill your Shatru or whatever. And also Vihita Tyagaha, that's the ninth one. Vihita Tyaga means you are ordained certain responsibilities. As a human being, you have to take care of parents, you have to take care of your Kula Devata, Grama Devatas, Nishta Devatas, and you have to take care of human beings, your Atithis. You have social responsibilities. You should not say that I am chanting, so ask him to come later. No, you have to find time, you have to balance out. Names you can chant, but your social responsibilities, your parental responsibilities, and your divine responsibilities, all those, that's all vihita karma. You have to fulfill them, don't do tyaga. That is the ninth avarada. The last one is karmantare samyam. Karmantara means like dana, danaha shaktihi kalav yuge, and also bhuri bhojana, giving food to many people. These are all good karmas, but don't consider Namajapa is equal to that. Don't consider that Namajapa is, they have their own value. They may be superior, but don't consider Namajapa is something inferior to them. So don't compare the Japayajna to other good karmas. Japa has its own greatness. So these are the 10 offenses one should avoid before chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama. Now we will go to the first verse of Vishnu Sahasranama. So it says, Sri Vaishampayana Uvacha Shrutva Dharmana Sheshena Pavanani Cha Sarvasaha Yudhishthirashantanavam Punarevabhyavashata. Now, he says, Sri Vaishampayana Uvacha. Who says this? Actually, the Suta Puranika, Suta Uvacha, that's how all the Purana starts, including Mahabharata. So, Suta is narrating this Puranas to Shaunaka. He's another Rishi. Suta Maharshi is telling it to Shaunaka Rishi. And in the course of the Purana, other people also come. So, Vaishampayana comes in that story, sub-story. So Vaisampayana is actually telling it to Janamejaya. So we don't know this context, so Shankara comments there. Shankara says, Vaisampayana Uvacha. Then he says, Janamejayam Prati. He is telling it to Janamejaya. And what is Vaisampayana telling to Janamejaya? Yudhishthira Shantanavam Abhyabhashata. He is saying that Yudhishthira asked Shantanu, son, Shantanavam. So that is the conversation. Vaishampayana telling Janamejaya that Yudhishthira is asking Bhishma. So that is how Puranas work. There will be several internal stories. Inside the story, there will be stories. So there Shankara comments that this Vaishampayana is actually telling it to Janamejaya. Because we don't see Janamejaya. He is explaining that. So what does he ask? Surtva dharman asheshena. Asheshena. Shesham means a little bit remaining. Ashesha means nothing to remain. Every dharma, every possible dharma has been explained by Bhishma to Yudhishthira. It is called Dana Dharma Parva. All the dharmas, Raja Dharma, Kshatriya Dharma, Brahmana Dharma, Sudra Dharma, Vaishya Dharma, Varnashrama Dharmas, Yati Dharma, Brahmachari Dharma, Grihastha Dharma, Vanaprastha Dharma, all these are Ashesha Dharma. All these dharmas was heard by Yudhishthira. Having Surtva, Pavanani, and they are all purifying. So here Shankara writes, what is this dharma? He says, Chodana Lakshanaha Dharmaha. So that actually is a sutra from Jaimini in the Mimamsa Shastra. Dharma, the first sutra is Athato Dharma Jijnasa. I now am going to inquire into Dharma. That's how Jaimini starts. And there are about 4000 sutras. And In the second sutra, he says, Chodana Lakshmanaha Dharmaha. Dharma means Chodana. That is the definition of Dharma. So Shankara actually quotes Jaimini, says that Dharma here is Chodana. So he agrees with the Purva Mimamsakas. Shankara will agree with all schools of thought as far as it is not against non-duality. If it agrees with Advaita, he will accept everyone. He will include everyone. Only thing is, he is very particular about Advaita. That unity and the non-duality, that oneness of the universal truth, that cannot be compromised. That is the only thing. So he accepts Jaimini's definition as Chodana Lakshana. So in Jaimini, there are several great commentators. Among Bhatta, Shabara, these are all commentators. Bhatta explains this Chodana as Chodana cha upadeshascha vidischa ekartha vachikaha. Chodana, upadesha and vidhi, all the three means the same. Remember last class we discussed about the main part of the Veda is vidhi. And that vidhi is martavya satato vishnuhu. Remember Vishnu always. The other part is nisheda, never forget him. So vidhi is the essence of Veda. And Chodana is the vidhi. So that is the definition of dharma. Dharma means vidhiyate, an injunction. It's a thing which says you do. For example, aharaha sandhyam upasita. Morning and evening you do upasana. We don't know that these are the junctures or these are the times that upasana has to be done. Unless we understand the Veda. Or vrdhavakya. Somebody who has read the Veda has to convey this. But the knowledge of upasana can come only from the Vedas. Other than that literature, we don't have any other source. So Veda is the only source for dharma. That is how Shankara defines this dharma. And this Chodana is, when you say it's just Chodana, then there are several Upadesha Vakyas in the Vedas, which says Satyam Vada, Dharmanchara, those will be excluded. That is why Bhatta is trying to say, it is not just prachodana, not just inspiring you to do actions, but it is also upadesha, instructions. So he wants to bring all these other vakyas under the purview of dharma. That is why the commentator of Mimamsa, of Mimamsa Shastra of Jaimini, he brings out the left out meaning. Because when the teacher first says, he assumes that people will understand all the aspects of dharma. But when time goes on, certain aspects becomes very unclear. So he clarifies it saying that it is not just injunction vidhi, it is also upadesha and chodana. Upadesha, chodana and vidhi, all the three are like chodana or dharma. Now this, what he essentially does is called vakya vichara or analysis of sentence. So this analysis of sentence, this Bhatta, Prabhakara, Misraj, they all have different ways of looking at the word dharma. How can it be possible means, in ancient India, linguistics of Panini, they had given so much of importance to brevity of expression. So, and they used to analyze sentences. In modern times, we have this theory called behavioral theory of in sentences. They take sentences and analyze it and have several theories of analyzing the meaning of sentences, like relative theory of sentences, or ideational theory of sentences in economics, in sociology. And ideational theory is when you say a car, that word car could mean only the car. Nothing else. This was proposed by John Locke in the 1600s. So, but the problem with this theory for later linguists was, who will decide that the car would tell only that object? So they couldn't fix the meaning. So they had to give away that idea of ideation theory of sentence and go to relational theory of sentence. In relational theory, attributes are explained by sentences. If you say that the brave boy jumps. So, the brave talks about the quality of the boy. the word boy talks about the person, and jumps talks about the action. So the actions, attributes, and people, person. That is explained by the sentences. But again, those are also not fixated for later linguistics. So they gave up, and the latest theory is the behavioral theory. It's widely used in economics and psychology. And this Jaimini's theory of sentences are very akin to this. When you say sarge kamo ejeta, for example, there is a Vedic sentence which says sarge kamo ejeta. So a person who is interested in Swarga should do the yaga. So it assumes people with only certain behavior who have read the Vedas, who have desire for the Swarga, will be inspired to do this act of Ashwamedha Yaga. Others will just hear it. It will not invoke any behavior in them. So all these theories were thought about and exposed by all these acharyas. If you look at all these great acharyas, they will spend a lot of time in hair-splitting arguments to bring out about these meanings of these words. Why they do is, they want to go into the ultimate meaning of the word, so that no doubt remains in expressing the ideas from these sentences. Then only they will be able to bring about their siddhanta or their conclusion about this. That's what Shankara is trying by quoting Jaimini. He wants to say that Mahabharata has Vedic status, and whatever tools you are using in the Vedic analysis, all the mimamsa, that can be applied herein. That's what he is trying to. It is all meta language. It is a little bit very technical, but it has to be applied because it is Panchama Veda, it's part of the Veda. So he, Shankara Bhashya, he uses this word Chodana Lakshanaha for Dharma. So Asheshena Dharman Srutva, having heard all these dharmas, which are Pavanani, Pavanani means which are purifying. There Shankara says, Pavana means Pavana Hetu, that which can purify you. How can it purify you? In two ways. He says, by giving you Abhyudaya and Nisrayas. Abhyudaya means the worldly accomplishments. For that you can do Vishnu's name chanting. Suppose you want more rupa or more food or more wealth. For that the chanting of the Sahasranama can be used, and you can get those worldly results by doing this. And also it can give you Nisrayas. It's called Moksha Dharma. You can get the final beatitude, final moksha by chanting the Vishnu Sahasranama. So it is both Abhyudaya and Nisraya Sahetur Dharmaha, which is presented in this Vishnu Sahasranama. That is why he says it is Pavanani. It is actually very purifying, because once you have these worldly desires, you cannot be pure. You will not be ready for meditation. So it does provide you with all this worldly success, and eventually when you are ready emotionally, mature, at that time it also can give you the Nisrayas, the final beatitude. And then what happened? Yudhishthiraha Shantanavam. So Shantanavam, he says, is Bhishma, because Shantanu had other children like Vijitravirya. So he also is Shantanu, like Pandava can be Arjuna and Yudhishthira. So he writes, it is Bhishma. In this context, Shantanu's son is Bhishma. To whom? Yudhishthiraha. Yudhishthiraha means one who is firm in Yuddha. Because Yudhishthira is a Kshatriya. In the Bhagavad Gita, because even after hearing all these dharmas, what are all dharmas? Nanacharan, Vividhan, Jati Dharman, Bhubhushate, Essa Para, Avaradnyaha. If you want to know about the world, you need to know all the Jati Dharmas, all the Varna Dharmas, all the Desha Dharmas. So if you go to London and if you say that I don't know the etiquette of the Englishman, then you cannot survive there. So you need to know how to behave. There was a minister from Bihar, so he had gone to sign a big deal. He went to London and he was offered this bowl with water, and there was also a lemon on the side. So he saw that guy and took this lemon and squeezed in this bowl. He did not realize it is a finger bowl. It was given to So he drank it. And aurai glaiye, bring one more. So that is not acceptable. You have to know all worldly, it is called vividhan jati dharman, all the different classes of society, different sections of society, you need to know their rules and regulations. If you say, I don't know the law, then the law is not at fault. Shankara says, Nayam sranur aparadaha idandhoyam napishati. You have a big pillar in the center of the hall, you go and hit it. It's not the fault of the pillar. So you need to, if you are a blind man, then you have to take help. But ask, what is the etiquette? How to walk in the hall? And you have to know this dharma. So all this dharma was explained by Bhishma. But punaha abhibhashata. Again, Yudhishthira is asking Bhishma. So Shankara is saying, is beautifully commending this word punaha, again. Shankara says, why again? Then Shankara says, because something was left over. What was left over? Though he had given all the etiquettes and all these dharmas, he had left over an easy path to moksha, which is Vishnu Sahasranama. So that is why he is punaha abhibhasha, he is asking. So Yudhishthira, for the benefit of the world, he wants Bhishma to spell that out. So that is how Shankara comments it. So with that, we will stop for today. The next class will be Yudhishthira Uvacha. Yudhishthira will be starting. Yeah, they are all, there is no pressure to, in Vedanta Svana, there is no pressure. So that's why we should not read it. In ancient time, Are Drishtavyaha Atma, Srotavyaha, Mantavyaha, Nirudhyasatavyaha. The knowledge of your Atman or of yourself has to be heard. Because hearing, it does something to you. The direct dialogue, because if you look at all our prayers, Sahana Avavato, Sahano Bhunaktu, Sahano means two, it is Duvachana, it's between the teacher and the student. So it's a transaction between only two people. So that's how these are all going to sink in your being. So first you take a cup of coffee and put sugar, and then you suddenly drink it, it will be very bitter, because you have stir it. That is called Abhyasa. That's called practice. But in time, they all will make sense. So in the beginning, when you hear all this, they all will be like, Tukda, here's one information, there one information. But that one picture will come in the right time. That's why Krishna says, Mattaha smritihi jnanam apohanancha. Mattaha smritihi. From Krishna comes remembrance. Jnanam. Understanding. Just because you remember, it doesn't mean that you understand. Then apohanam, also forgetfulness. You can also totally miss it or misunderstand it. Everything comes from me. So the idea is just to listen, and it will all make sense. All these myriad stories, there is an essence to all this. That will come in time.
So one thing I didn't understand, you said don't do Vishnu Sahasranama just with expectation or some gains. Is that right? Is something you said, right, in between?
No. All the 10 rules, they are all offenses. And expecting something is not an offense. Because Krishna says, expectation means desire. You're expecting, is it wrong to expect something out of chanting this Vishnu Sahasranama? I said there are two results, Abhyudaya and Nisrayasa. Abhyudaya is worldly results. You can expect it.
You can.
And Vishnu Sahasranama will give you that. So, because
materialistic.
It is materialistic and it is okay. Because Krishna says, Dharma aviruddho kamosmi. I am Kama. Krishna is actually the grandfather of Kama. Kama is nothing but Pradyumna, who is grandson of Krishna. So it is Krishna's power. So Krishna is actually all desires. But it has to be dharma aviruddha. It should not go against dekram of the Vedas, of the Vedic injunctions. So those terms are met, then you can ask for houses or for more wealth. They all have dharmic usages. So we can ask for more and more. But you will not be ready for Vedanta until you develop that Vairagya. Because you will understand while hearing that these are all cyclic. By getting a house, you are only wanting to have a desire for a bigger house. By wanting a car, you are only wanting to have a better car. By wanting money, you are only having to have more money. So that is very cyclic. Kshine punye marti lokam vishanti. So by doing all this kama requests, finally you'll get big swarga. But even that swarga, when your punya, which you got out of Vishnu Sahasranama, diminishes, then you'll have to come down. And then again, you have to try for moksha. Once you get moksha, it's like pure bliss. It is more beautiful than all these kamas. So hence, it is not wrong to ask for abhyudaya or worldly kama, but nisrayas is the best. And that is reserved only for people who are very close to Vishnu. Krishna says, Chaturvidha bhajan demam. Four kind of people come and do bhajana to me. Janaha sukritino Arjuna. Hey Arjuna, they are sukritis. They have done lot of good karmas in their past. And who are they? Artaha, number one. The person who wants... Artaha means a person who is in difficulty. Artha means one who is in pain. One who has lost a loved one. Or one who has money in lottery. One who is suffering. One who is in pain. That's Artaha. That's the number one. He will come to the temple, to Krishna. Number two, Artharthi. One who wants Artha. One who wants money. Some Prayojana. Artha means Prayojana. Or basically money. The third one, Artharthi. Jijnyasuhu. One who is curious. What is in there? What is written in that? He wants to know. And the fourth one is Jnani. The last one is the one who has understood. He has gone through the stages in previous lives or in this life. He has attained that spiritual maturity, and that is Jnani. Tesham Jnani Nitya Yuktaha Same Bhakta Same Priya. Among all these four, Jnani is the most dearest to me because he is Nitya Yuktaha. He never falls from the path, and he is Priya. And Jnani Tvatmeva Me Matam. He is my own Atma. There is no difference me and he has attained Krishna, so he has no difference. Hence, that is the, idealistically, that is the best desire. But we shouldn't get stuck with hopes or futuristic things. Wherever you are, that's where you have to blossom. If you are on earth, blossom here. Once you reach heaven, you can do things which are proper in Vaikuntha or Brahmaloka or Shivaloka. But here, in whichever stage God has kept you, in which wherever you are, from there you start. Intensely, if you pray, then he will give you. And there is no greater gain other than gaining Krishna, becoming him.
There's another one I want to ask you, which caused confusion. You said, just for the sake of meditation, if you desire to meditate and sit down to meditate, you can never attain meditation.
No, because...
What if the Guru guides you and tells you?
The Guru only can guide you. Guru can only tell you. My mother can come, sleep. Will you sleep? If you have a desire to listen to some music or something you want to do, if that is blocking your thing, will you be able to sleep? Tell me. You won't be able to sleep. Similarly, meditation also. Meditation is what? Becoming one with... What is meditation? Meditation means Tailadharavat Manasaha Avichinena Vastushu Avasthanam. Avasthanam means stability, staying in vastu. How? Just like a stream of oil. When the oil is flowing, there is no break. It is just one streak. Just like that, the mind has to flow into the vastu, the object of meditation. That is called meditation. And that cannot be forced. You just cannot force that state because it is an internal state which cannot be forced. So that is why in the Yoga Sutras, he says the first sutra is Yogaha or meditation, Chitta Vritti Nirodaha. All you can do is the Nirodha of all your external thoughts, your hankerings for this, that. That if you just a cessation, when all those recede, what is left is meditation. That cannot be forced.
Okay, thank you.
That is what I meant. So I was not saying that it is impossible, but it is not will-based. Just like making a chapati is your will-based. It's an action. You can say that my chapati is square, a triangle, or a round-shaped one. But you cannot will that in the case of meditation. It is not an objective. It's not an object you can see or attain. It is an experience, which is you. You being yourself, that is meditation. For that only you can create that situation. You can create that situation, but you cannot force that.
So with discipline and practice, they say meditation is possible.
Yes.
If your guru guides you.
Yeah.
Your guru tells you what to do.
The only way is guru's guidance.
Blessing of the grace and blessing grace of the guru. Yes. That would happen.
Yes. So even then it's not your will. See, Guru's grace.
It'll happen. No, you have to have a yearning too for that.
Yes. That's why in the beginning he says, Samischayana Yoktavyaha. You have to have that earning.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have that will to do. But there ends your path. Beyond that, it is the object of meditation, then it takes over. Vishnu or Krishna, he takes over.
So that's what you mean is we should not be analyzing, we should practice him. We should practice what Guru says, spend our time, and then it's not our will that we can reach him, but when he thinks, he will attract us,
right,
put us back to the connection with the
right.
Almighty. Yes.
By grace of the God and grace of the Guru,
right,
that will lead you.
That will manifest. That state will manifest in you.
Yes.
It is not something you can do just... You can fight and get like worldly things. Meditation is a very a spiritual dimension. You becoming yourself. Yourself means Krishna. You are the taranga. You are the wave. Krishna is the big ocean. And when you merge in the ocean, then you become that. And it can be savikalpa or nirvikalpa. Savikalpa means you'll come back. You meditate, you go there and come back. Nirvikalpa means you stay there. So there are these different kinds of meditations also explained in the Patanjali Yoga Sutras. But any meditation cannot be will-based. You cannot will it and force it. Even the guru will not... Words stop there. That is what meditation is. You cannot just say that I started meditation at 10:15. You will never be able to say that. Just say that around 10 o'clock I sat and 15 hours later I woke up. Or 15 minutes later I woke up. I had a brief spell. But you can never pinpoint that moment because it is not will-based. The time disappears.
Best way is to connect with him all the time. But you do need a guru who will give his power behind that meditation which you'll do. Then we are going to practice and try to, you know, connect as much as we can. And if 24 hours we can connect with him, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Whatever we are doing, but if you are connected to him, that's the best way, isn't it?
Yeah. The idea of meditation is this, having ekagra chitta and then sitting, and it happens. But and that cannot be forced. That cannot be because of your will. But all this peripheral, anugraha of Guru, anugraha of Ishta, and your own humility, your own sadhana chaturthaya sampatti, all these great qualities you have, sama, dhamma, titiksha, uparidhi, shraddha, you all can be peripheral helpings. And then it can happen.
And those 10 rules, we had to be...
That is for chanting Vishnu Sahasranama.
Just for chanting Vishnu Sahasranama, but it is... Can't we use there also for when we sit on meditation, that we want to make sure that we are not having any ahankar or disrespecting anybody, and then we are just connecting?
Yeah. All good things can be intermittently useful, but especially when you do Vishnu Sahasranama, at least at that point, like one Mahatma, I think it is Ramdas in Kanyangad, when you enter the temple, what you do is put your pair of your slippers outside. Mm-hmm. Just like that, put the pair of opposites of raga and dvesha, everything outside, and then enter the altar. And then you remain in that state. Once you are done, then you can go back to hating your neighbor and back and settle. But at this, at least this, because you cannot expect to shed away everything overnight. That is what in the last class we said. Abhijit Sudhuracharaha, even though he is a Durachari, he has bad qualities. Sadhureva Mantaviha, consider him as to be sadhu, because Kaunteya Pradijanihi, hey Kaunteya, hey Arjuna, I am doing this Pradijna. I am actually promising you, Name Bhakta Pranashyati, my Bhakta will never perish. So that assurance is there. Okay, then. We'll meet in the next class. Thank you. Thank you.